What happens when John Kent, the new Superman, comes face to face with Lex Luthor, his father's arch nemesis? Well, let's hop into the pages of Superman Son of Kal-El Annual 2021 and find out together, shall we? So then, this book actually opens up with a trip to the past and another time where Lex Luthor had almost killed the Man of Steel, this time by weaponizing Metallo and his kryptonite payload. Of course, Lex being Lex, though, he couldn't leave it at that. He had to gloat about how amazingly brilliant this plan is and how he was going to get away with it scot-free. Turns out, though, that wasn't actually Metallo at all, but Martian Manhunter masquerading as Metallo to try and get Lex to incriminate himself, which he was all too happy to do. Superman opines that while Lex considers himself the smartest man in the room, he sure gets beaten by Superman a lot, a guy who doesn't claim to be that smart at all. Lex ends up getting carted off to jail, but Superman knows full well that none of this is going to stick, because none of it ever sticks to Lex Luthor. When you're rich, powerful, and ambitious, you always seem to be able to skirt the law. This time, though, Superman does decide to visit him in prison, and the two have themselves a little chess game while talking about how different their lives could have been if maybe they got off on a different foot. Imagine if they weren't enemies, but allies. Lex Luthor, the man of infinite vision, and Superman, the man of infinite reach, together they could probably be unstoppable. They could probably save the world as we know it. But, as we all know, that didn't work out. Now back in the present, John in his role as Superman is using his amazing vision to try and scan the cosmos to see where his father ended up. Unfortunately for the new young Man of Steel, what's happening on Warworld and beyond is completely lost to him. John has an interesting little heart-to-heart with his mother, saying that if Lois really wanted, she probably could have kept Superman from going, but part of being Superman's wife and partner is knowing full well that he doesn't belong to you fully, he belongs to everyone who needs him. This just being one of the many harsh lessons that John himself is learning as he grows into the role of Superman. It's at that moment, too, the Kents have a visitor in the form of Batman. I like, even though John has met Batman many times before, he's caked in shadow when he sees him, almost like he's seeing him for the first time in this new role, because, well, he is. Lois and John offer Bruce some Earl Grey tea. They have plenty, because get this, Alfred sends Earl Grey tea to every place that he thinks Master Bruce may visit at some point. At first, mother and son think that Batman is here to try and recruit young John for the Justice League, but he actually has a message, a Kryptonian crystal left by Clark himself before he departed Earth. To play it, John is going to have to make a pilgrimage to the Fortress of Solitude. It's on his way there he finds a poor pregnant polar bear stuck on an ice floe. John saves the bear and even adopts it, naming it Gale, which I feel has to be a reference to Gail Simone, famous comic writer and lover of bears. Also, saving a polar bear from the horrors of climate change is something that has really become a consistent thing with John's character. He worries about the Earth and humans' future on it. And I mean, really, why shouldn't he when we stop and consider that Clark's home planet of Krypton was destroyed because of ecological disaster that no one bothered to deal with? Speaking of Krypton, the crystal that Batman gave him is actually a special AI backup of Clark's mind, pretty much exactly what Clark had with his own father, Jor-El. As John quickly notes, the AI isn't perfect, it can't tell him where his real father is right now, but it's been programmed to be a sounding board for John to help get his inner thoughts out, and also hopefully answer any other question he might have about being Superman. John actually does pose the question about helping save the Earth from ecological disaster, and why even someone like Superman with their amazing powers feels so, well, powerless in this situation. The Clark AI notes that climate change is a real tough nut to crack. Those who could actually make a difference in this problem either don't want to face the reality of what's going on, or just plain old don't understand it for one reason or another. People like, well, Lex Luthor. What's old Lex been up to recently? Well, trying to rebuild his company and his own personal fortune after torpedoing it all in the prelude to Death Metal. And his plan to get it all back is suitably supervillain. He sends a bunch of tablets, as well as empty boxes, to some of the richest and most prevalent people in big business and crime. I personally like the little connective tissue of getting to see Blockbuster amongst this group of people, considering that he's the main Nightwing villain over in the book that Tom Taylor is also writing. Lex says that he's put a dangerous nanoweapon inside each one of these empty boxes, and unless they send him $1.7 billion each, he will activate the weapon and make it seem like they all died of regular old strokes. Some of them think Lex is bluffing right now, but at the same time, they can't exactly be 100% sure, so they decide it's best to just send him the money and get out of this Schrodinger's death scenario. With this newest infusion of cash, Lex decides to buy the tallest building in Metropolis and emblaze it with his own name in giant letters, letters so big they cast a shadow over the Daily Planet. Which, of course, when John finds out about this, it positively boils his blood, not just because of the obvious dick move that he's pulling here, but also how the hell is Lex Luthor allowed to keep doing this kind of stuff? It's not like the world doesn't know that he founded the Legion of Doom and tried to destroy the world with Perpetua not that long ago. You'd think that would sour a person's public relations, but not when you're Lex, though. As Lois so eloquently puts it, the worst thing about guys like Lex Luthor is that their psychopathy is often seen as admirable by certain people. He's the type of person that many weak people often wish they could be. They cheer on his evil deeds because he's the absolute worst kind of aspirational figure imaginable. That's still not to say Lex doesn't have a whole laundry's list of enemies. A group of heavily armed robots start attacking the building, which means John has to get involved as Superman to save people from getting crushed by debris. Lex is certainly happy for the assist, him getting involved in his own classic battle suit, but John is sure to say, look, I'm just fighting over here, you're fighting over there, this is not a team up. Though, he says that, and by the end of the fight, John ultimately does save Lex's life, even though he didn't have to, because, well, that's just what Superman does now. Isn't it? Apparently, these robots were supposed to be protecting Lex, but because he used parts from one of the people that he extorted earlier on in the story, they turned against him. Having all this one-on-one time with John actually reminds Lex of the chess game they played once before, and he would like to finish it with John. John is, of course, busy in his new role as Superman, but he agrees to the game on the condition that if he wins, despite the fact that he's never played chess before, Lex will have to take his big gaudy sign down. And thus, the game begins on top of Lex's own building. It's here that John mentions something his father had said before, that Luthor has all this money, all this power, prestige, and luxury, and yet none of it is good enough for him. Because at the end of the day, what a man like Luthor is really after is a sense of control, something that is hard to have when there's all-powerful Kryptonian aliens running around. It's that same hunger for control that makes it so Lex always ends up surviving. There's nothing he can never get around. Goes to jail, no worries, he'll get out. Tried to take over the world with the Legion of Doom, no worries, he'll cook up some story about Gorilla Grodd controlling his mind and make a plea deal. Even if the world was to end tomorrow, it probably wouldn't affect Lex. He'd just put his brain in a giant robot or clone a new body or something. It's for all those reasons and more John tries to say to Lex that the problems of the world in the here and now will be his problems too. And that, well, indeed the original Superman and Lex got off on the wrong foot. Maybe this new Superman can have a new type of relationship with Lex. Maybe they can both be on the same page about trying to help the world. Well, from ecological disaster at least, John ultimately ends up winning the game too. In his 7-minute break, he read every single book he could on the matter of chess, and was also sure to look at the outcome of every one of Luthor's official chess matches since the age of 6, because of course Lex is such a narcissist, he would want those scores out for the world to see. Once again, Lex was so sure of his own superiority, he completely underestimated this new young Superman, and he paid the price for it. John takes down the sign, but he allows Luthor to keep the big L, because, well, you know. John also leaves Lex with a lot to think about. Maybe he does want to change the way he does things. Maybe he does want to try and save the world. The only problem is, to do that, he decides to reach out to Henry Bendix. Apparently, Bendix has been trying to get Lex involved with something called The Rising for a long time now, and it seems that Luthor is finally ready to acquiesce as the comic comes to an end. And so that was Superman Son of Kal-El Annual 2021, and I gotta say, I really enjoyed this one. They packed a ton of story into the annual format. Also, while a lot of the newer DC annuals that came out in the last couple weeks are easily skippable, I would say this is one that you positively do need to read because there's so much stuff in here that's no doubt gonna be important later. This is also a story I've been dying to see for a long time now, what it means when a new younger Superman goes up against his father's greatest foe and how they would treat each other. I like John continuing to care about the bigger picture, and his enthusiasm is so infectious it even manages to get to Luthor a little bit, even if Luthor still has to Luthor it up in the end. I also like that this story seeks to imply that Luthor will continue continue to be a threat in the background, but also allow John the freedom as Superman to build his own unique rogues gallery.
Overall, I'd feel comfortable giving this one an 8 out of 10. This was solid.
Hey there everyone, Kate Joel again, and I just want to thank you so much for watching to the end of the video. It means a lot to me. And hey, if you enjoyed the book I covered in this issue and want some comics of your own, might I recommend Book Depository? It's my number one place for shopping for comic book trades. You get a great price, and if you use my link down in the description, you'll actually be helping me out at the same time. You get something, I get something, everybody wins, right? So until next time everyone, I've been Joel, and I will see you in the next video. Bye-bye.